Hey everybody, welcome to the shop on a Friday afternoon this time. I actually skipped last week because that's the way things go. There's been a lot happening in the world of aviation that I've been keeping up to by watching Blanco Lirio's channel. Very good. A lot of things I'd like to have a comment on, but I'm not really qualified. I try to stick to the stuff that I know. So while I sit here in front of an Arenda 10 and an Arenda 14, both of which are not fitted with Vickers guns. This is the air intake to the starter. That's the starter motor. 30 volts, 400 amps rated. It's got an inrush current of up to 750 amps. Yeah. Okay, so the last video that I made on turbine overspeed and inlet debris screens, it's over there. Quite a few people actually commented with something that is very relevant to what I do. So we're going to discuss it today because I have a personal connection to it and I have the photographs to prove it. Okay, where's my phone? Here's my phone. The most recent person to comment on this was definitely not the first. There's just, when I get comments, there's like a waterfall of comments and there's not really a way to keep track of the comments. When there's a lot of them, they get kind of down this huge list and it's hard to find them again. I guess that's one of the luxuries and punishments of being or having a fairly popular video. Anyway, it's this happened quite a bit to this particular plane. It's a Russian-built IL-62 passenger jet plane. It looks a lot like the British Vickers VC-10. A bit like a DC-9, but with two engines on either side of the back. And like an MD-80, MD-90, but with two, not just one engines. Kind of cool. Anyway, this was lot flight 5055. Now, I've followed the links people have provided and read a little bit about it. Basically, one of the engines lost a low pressure turbine because the shaft failed, because the bearing failed and caught fire. And the bearing failed because there were only half as many rollers in it as there should have been. And the story was that there were deadlines to meet, contracts going to expire, and there wasn't enough rollers in the factory, which is pretty pathetic if you ask me. Because what happened with lot flight 5055 is I think there were 183 people dead in that crash. And that wasn't the only crash of this airliner. There's been several. I think at least two of them have been from the same issue. So it's an ongoing thing. And when I first read this story, I was saddened and shocked, and I got angry. So I made a video about it 2 weeks ago, and luckily the files were corrupted. Must be a sign from somewhere, because my video files never get corrupted, and this video wouldn't load the footage into the soft editing software. I tried and tried, it wouldn't work. Anyway, I got angry because such an irresponsible move, I'll show you exactly what I mean. No matter what the excuse, I believe the person that assembled that bearing and their supervisor, they're directly responsible for the deaths of those people. And usually with aviation accidents, of a nature like that, the person directly responsible never pays, might have lost their job, maybe their factory shuts down, maybe not. But there's never any real punishment because it's usually never specifically pointed out that you or this caused it. Because like all aircraft, airliner accidents, it's usually a sequence of small events and small mistakes that anybody could have made, but they all seem to line up in a row, and when they all line up, that's when disaster happens. So I got really upset at this story because it's something that just makes me shiver. And I think that everybody that I've ever worked with in this industry, whether they're industrial engines or for jet engines in aircraft, fighter jets, or airliners, they just shake their heads. They can't believe it. So let's take a quick look at what I'm talking about. Okay, we're over here at the messy computer corner, and this is a picture that I saw when I was disassembling a group of engines, actually. So I found this in two out of five engines I took apart. I found this situation in two of them. So I don't know if you can really tell there, but and it's not an optical illusion. There's a roller. There's an empty spot. There's a roller. There's an empty spot. There's a roller. I'll take the next picture here. There is the carrier. This is the last three digits of the serial number of a very long serial number of this engine. This is the rear bearing of the low pressure turbine shaft. It's a two shaft engine. And you can see this is not a special carrier. That's not a bigger space than that. I know it looks like it. It's kind of an optical illusion. But this is a carrier with only half as many rollers in the carrier. So I think the load on the line load on the rollers, it's not just doubled here. I think there's more of an effect than that. Anyway, whoever decided to put that in there, that's a horrible thing. So when I first saw that, I saw the first one and I thought, well, this is strange. I haven't worked on this engine before. And it's metric, just a bit different than what I'm used to. So I thought, is this a factory technique? Is this supposed to be like this? Because when engines get into the aftermarket, they often do get worked on by people who have different, let's say they have different backgrounds. I'm not going to say anybody's unqualified, but I just said that. I'm going to say that the people from different backgrounds may disassemble and reassemble parts of the engines. The only thing is the main line bearings on the rotating shafts of a turbofan or a turbojet engine, that's in there. That's where most other trades would rather not be. And so the only people that get that far inside an engine are usually people like me with experience working on gas turbine engines, and they're quite familiar with things. They have the instructions, and they also know there's, I'm not going to call it common sense, I'm going to call it knowledge of good practices in the shop and with working on engines. Those good practices are different with V8 engines, piston engines, big diesel engines, ship engines, and gas turbine engines. So when I saw this, I thought, I had confidence that usually when you take apart an engine, it's done the right way. It's a bad assumption to make, but it's an assumption I used to always make, that the way that I take this apart is the way that it goes back together. So I looked at that bearing carrier. The races were fine, the inner and outer race. It's a roller bearing so that the races are smooth. There's a track in the outer race to keep the rollers from sliding, but the inner race can slide like this, and that allows for thermal expansion of the shaft in the engine. So I thought, okay, let's just, we'll keep this aside and we will take the next one apart. So I found the same thing in the next one. So I had all five engines apart. We had lots of space. And I was scratching my head and I was thinking, this is not right. Again, we didn't have the full overhaul manual with pictures and pictures of the bearings, because a manual does not say put all 17 rollers into the 17 slots in the carrier for the rear race or the rear bearing, roller bearing, and install it. It doesn't say that, because it's just like with the rollers in the bearings and the wheels and the axles of your car. It doesn't say put 9 rollers into the conical tapered roller. It doesn't say that. It just says put the bearing in, because it's assumed that you just take the bearing as a unit and stick it in. Well, the bearings all come apart in these engines. And I'm now firmed up in my opinion that they don't need to tell you the number of rollers to put into the bearing, because you put everyone in. That's what they're for. That's how they're designed. You wouldn't drive a car with 3 wheels. You use 4. It doesn't say put 4 wheels, 4 tires on your car. It just says put the wheels on. If it says that anywhere, you put them all in. Anyway, so interestingly enough, on the last of this series of 5 engines, I found one bearing, the same bearing. All the rollers were in, but the whole thing was loose. I didn't notice this until we were had the engine upright. We're going to put the rear frame on, and I bumped into the engine, and the shaft moved a little bit. I'm like, what? Well, what it was is that bearing should hold that shaft in the whole engine radially, absolutely rigid. It allows for expansion axially, but radially it's a bearing. It locates it in place with great strength. So it wobbled. And I took the bearing back out, took the rollers out, and I measured them. And they were 9 millimeters in diameter. And all the other ones were 9.5. And this wasn't wear. The surface finish on the rollers and the finish on the races was beautiful. They were the wrong size. And I was shocked, because how does somebody get that far into an engine that they're dealing with the mainline bearings and they're so clueless or careless or both that they put the wrong size in for whatever reason? Don't tell me you don't have the right size. If you don't have the right size, then you wait for them before you put the engine together. Okay, I'm getting a bit off track here, but so that bearing was wrong. 3 out of 5 engines, the bearings were wrong. And the two that had every other one, yeah, they did run for a while, but it's not designed to be like that. It's designed to have all the bearing rollers in there. So, this story, Lot Flight 5055, that I'd never heard of before, happened in 1987. Those people were killed because somebody put not enough rollers in the bearing for whatever the excuse is. Whatever your excuse, don't be ridiculous. Those people died. 183 people, and other crashes where other people died for the same stupid reason, incredibly stupid reason. And if any message I want to get out from this video is that people like me don't do that. And I don't think anybody that I've met would do that, that works in this industry. I wasn't as horrified as I should have been when I first found that, because these engines, they were running. They came to us to be refurbished and repaired. There was no damage. It's one of those things you can get away with, I guess. It's a very, 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 very irresponsible and a very bad practice. And I don't want to endorse anybody, but all the people that I know that work on these engines, they wouldn't even think of putting a bearing like that into an engine. Even if the reason is, well, we just can't get those rollers, that's just not true. Bearing rollers are one of the most common things available everywhere. And for a factory that builds gas turbine engines to say we don't have them, that's ridiculous. So I'm gonna say, in my personal opinion, the person who put that bearing in that engine and the person who built that bearing, if they're not the same people, those people and the supervisor of those people, they are directly responsible for the deaths of those 183 people and others that went down in the same type of plane with the same type of engine with the same type of bearing built the same wrong way. I couldn't believe it. Anyway, this whole issue made me emotional because I've seen it. And I hate to say it wasn't a close call, but even that I had the slightest doubt that, is that the way it's supposed to be? No, it's not the way it's supposed to be. And thank goodness I put them all together correctly and they're all running. Anyway, I don't know whether this is a cautionary tale or what, but I just felt like I had to say something about that type of work does not happen in this shop. In any of the shops I've worked in, that type of work does not happen. I just can't believe it. I can't believe it. I can't believe it. So, thanks for watching and have a good weekend.